So we were very clear that if we have to impact these 1.7 million schools or a certain section of these schools, we must first understand what it means to run schools in rural India in difficult circumstances. So you start building student leadership. Once you start building student leadership and they start taking charge, the school changes.
So today we're joined in conversation by Ms. Mamta Sekia, who's the Chief Executive Officer of Bharti Foundation, the development arm of Bharti Enterprises, one of India's leading business groups with interests in telecom, agribusiness, financial services, retail, realty, and communications and media devices. As the CEO of Bharti Foundation, Mamta plays a key role in project expansion and enhancement of quality standards and system efficiency, while constantly keeping the team morale high to deliver their best in challenging circumstances. She leads the development of the organization and its education programs at primary, elementary, and secondary standards. Through her experience, clear vision, and strategic thinking, she has also been able to establish a successful and replicable model of public-private partnership. Thank you so much for joining us, Mamta. It's a pleasure to have you today. To begin with the conversation, so from the time that you joined the organization to now where it stands today, so what has the experience been, working with it firsthand with the interventions from the very beginning? And how has that experience shaped your perception of the domain of education and the few other thematic areas that you touch on a daily basis?
Thank you, Deepak. Very interesting question. And of course, it covers the journey of Bharti Foundation and with that, my journey as well. I was the first employee of Bharti Foundation. It was still a very small organization when I joined, and I joined Bharti in 2004. Bharti Foundation was set up in 2000. So initial years, there were very senior level directors who were kind of looking after the foundation together. And being the first employee, so to say, I've seen the journey that Bharti Foundation has taken. And of course, it has been an immense, immense journey for me as well, to grow, to get exposure to completely new. I would say it many a times has changed my paradigm on how I looked at things. I'll take you through the journey first. So initially, Bharti Foundation used to work with NGOs, and like any corporate foundation would. So I'm talking early 2000s. We would partner NGOs. We would look at the proposals, we look at their projects, and we would partner them. A very interesting phase because it gave us exposure to various issues. It gave us exposures to various sizes of NGOs. And, so I do come from the sector itself, and I worked with an organization like CRY, which worked with smaller NGOs. So I did have that kind of exposure with me. When I joined Bharti. Yeah. But while working with Bharti, I worked on some of the really large scale projects. We have this Bharti School of Telecom and Management with IIT Delhi. It was a project, at a completely strategic level because it was among the first schools that was in 2000, it was set up. When I joined, it was already, I think the first batch or second batch was already there in place. So it was among the first schools in the country which was producing telecom engineers. Telecom was an upcoming industry and sector. So I got immense exposure, and I think Bharti Foundation as an institution therefore gathered, institutional knowledge on various sizes of projects, various kind of partners, a lot of interesting partnerships. In that period after I joined, the trustees took a call that we must now try and focus on an issue. So then I think the initial strategic planning of Bharti Foundation took place in the year 2004 to 2006. So while we changed our paradigm of working, few decisions were taken in 2004, but we took that time to find out what else is happening, where is it that we can actually make a difference. So 2004 to 2006, we had decided that we'll work in education. And we had said that, okay, let's first try and focus on reading, because you know that reading capability and quality of education. So we were quite focused on foundational learning. Today it's a buzzword, but in our earlier years itself, we were focused on junior classes, their ability to read and comprehend, etc. So we started a library program and we worked with some of the unknown NGOs in places like Assam and all, and some of the well-known NGOs like Pratham, in North India and Central India. And while in that phase, we were gathering our learnings from these library program and a computer center program where we used to take old computers from our group companies, into schools, refurbish them. So a lot of learning from the ground at that point of time. And parallelly, we were working with our board to see that what is the direction that we should take. So in 2006, we launched our flagship Satya Bharti school program. And what was the thought behind it? India is a country with 1.5, 1.7 million schools.
Yep.
Correct? There is no NGO, no corporate foundation which can operate at that scale.
True.
Correct? All of us can only add value, perhaps sometimes pick up a very small cluster and work with those schools. But there is no foundation or nobody who can look at these 1.7 million schools. So we were very clear that if we have to impact these 1.7 million schools or a certain section of these schools, we must first understand what it means to run schools in rural India in difficult circumstances. It's been 16, 17 years now. For last 8-9 years, we've been working very closely with government schools. And I must put it on record, the kind of challenges that government teachers and government schools have, there is some really impressive work happening on the ground.
Yeah.
At times one doesn't understand the challenges, and each school is a world in itself. You can't just paint one solution, over 10,000 schools. Each school is a world in itself. It is very easy to find faults. We know that there are certain areas in which government schools may be struggling, but there's a lot of work that has got done. So we thought that we must first experience what it means to run schools, what are the challenges, because till the time you've not done it yourself, right? We felt that the legitimacy to our interventions in government schools will not be very strong. And I very sincerely believe, and I've heard it from many principal, government principals on the ground, the respect that Bharti Foundation has today is because of our, 180 plus schools that we have on the ground and in the villages. Because people have seen the kind of work that we've done. And I'm not saying that all our schools are exceptional. There's always a bell curve, right? But we have struggled with each of the challenges. We're still struggling with COVID and the kind of challenges that it posed. We have come out with practices and programs which are practical, easy to understand and easy to implement. Our philosophy is if you can't make a process simple, then it will completely be lost in its translation and execution, right? So excellent looking process is not necessarily working excellently on the ground itself. And that's the feedback we receive from government school principals, that when Bharti Foundation comes with a solution, we know that we can do it. It's doable, right? And when something is doable and then it gets done, it gives impact. Of course, it may not be at 100, but you will still get 70, 80, you will reach the level of 70, 80. And it's important that teachers should do it. So started a journey of Satya Bharti school program, and it was challenging, Deepak, to work with sarpanches, to work with panchayats, to hear their aspirations, that if there are schools coming from the Bharti group, what their aspirations were. Our trustees were very clear that these will be completely free of cost schools, because we did not want any kind of entry barrier for children. You see, sometimes what happens is, even if you say schools are free, but if a child has to pay for notebooks or pencils or pens, etc., and parents have limited money, there would be times that perhaps a boy child would reach the school, but a girl child may not reach the school, right? So we wanted to make sure that a child just has to walk in, right? All barriers have to be removed. And the expectations from the villagers were very high from us. So, you know, to map their expectations, to create a school design. And I've told you our philosophy of simplicity, right? The second was the corporate DNA. So before our schools came up, Deepak, our SOP for schools came up first, right? Of course, we've gone through, I mean, within 2 years, we had to do a more practical and reasonable version of our standard operating procedures because, you know, when you hit the ground, then you realize what works, what doesn't work. But what learning, you know, each school posed different kind of challenges. Each group of teachers posed different kind of challenges. Each time there is some, you know, when RT came in, then you had to completely sometimes reinvent the way you were doing things. And it was, you know, so we started a school program in 2006. And what I realized, Deepak, that you kind of assume that perhaps parents who are not literate do not understand the value of education, right? You sometimes assume that, oh, would they understand what quality education is, right? But they do. Right? Their aspirations may be articulated in a manner which are simplistic. So the job belongs to educationists and people like us to understand what is it that they are trying to say.
Definitely.
But their dreams and their aspirations are right. Right. You know? So we've had parents who want their children to be IAS officers. They've seen DMs. They want their daughter to be a DM. And secondly, we've seen slowly you know, their aspiration for the girls also. That is one part I'm actually really very proud of, because in our schools, you know, our philosophy is very clear. Of course, learning levels are important, right? But we are working with underprivileged children. So we work a lot on holistic development. You know, a child coming from an underprivileged family, we find sometimes can be shy, very underconfident. They're not sure of their voice, right? That if I say something, is it of importance? Will it be heard? They have no prior exposure in the family that my chacha is a postman, my taya, tai is a teacher or things like that, right?
It is limited in a way.
So you actually have to work with them from a very overall perspective, even to give them that confidence to speak, right? To speak what is in their mind, to question. So we work on that philosophy. So in 2012-13, we had a meeting with our board. We'd been running Satya Bharti school program since 2006. And we said that, you know, while we are still learning, I mean, nobody can say that they've reached a stage where now we know how to run schools. We have the gold standard processes for everything. So every day is a learning experience. But since 2006, we have gathered enough good practices, and I think we are ready to work with government schools, you know, to take some of our good practices over there.
Yes.
So in 2012, we took a call to start working with government schools now. And our model was very different, right? Our belief is that if you make schools a happy and vibrant place, right? And a happy and a vibrant place, not only for teachers, not only for students, but also for teachers, also for principal, as well as for parents, right? So if it is a place everybody looks forward to come to, right? That would mean the teachers would come every day in school wanting to do better than what they did yesterday, right? Wanted to do the best to their capability. Students will come to school every day. So if you're not taking chutti, right? You would be studying. You know what happens is, for one day you're not there, you miss the periods of yesterday, right? And when you go on to the next day's class, most of the children then lose out on what was taught, and you don't get that concept, right? So more regular a child is, the learning is then built in a structured manner. So if you have children coming every day because they're happy coming to school, overall schooling performance will improve. If parents start coming in, right? Most of the time we hear that that PTM parents are not coming. If parents are not participating, then a child will not perform to her full potential, right? So our philosophy was very clear that we will not intervene in the teaching learning processes of schools. because we have some exceptional teachers. The government selection criteria is very difficult, right? You have to clear test and so there are some very good quality teachers and principals in government schools already. We did not want to intervene in that area. We said, let's take the philosophy of Satya Bharti schools there. Let's make these schools happy and vibrant, right? So that is the philosophy with which we went. And obviously, initially, people were a little surprised at our approach. And as a challenge, you won't believe it, we were given some only 8 schools in 3 states. Okay. 2 schools in X state, 2 schools in Y state, and 4 schools in another state, right? Because people said, what is this approach? Wouldn't you come with, you know, some new teaching learning process or computer program or something like that? And we started this program. By the time that year ended, you know, even today, we have a waiting list. At any point of time, principals writing to our local staff saying, can you please include our school also into your program? You see, what happens is a happy school and happy staff and happy children, it turns the school around, right? So if you become proud of your school, you will make sure it's clean, correct? And of course, our staff helps. You know, the things that we do is we would enter a school and first we will obviously look at cleanliness and infrastructure. We don't put in large amounts in infrastructure. We start involving community, right? Because no school should get dependent on Bharti Foundation and Bharti Foundation's funds, yeah. Right? We may give a little bridge funding. So community may come in and community may say, okay, hum aapke room mein white, aapke schools mein whitewash kar denge, correct? But now toilet requires some repair. It requires a, you know, pot or it requires a flush system. So that kind of little bridge funding we do,
okay.
Right? But we make sure that community teachers and children get together. So there is plantation happens, greenery happens, the school painting wash, you know, you do whitewash or school painting. Then we start establishing student clubs and houses. Now clubs, there are many clubs and we're very happy since we've started the program. I can't take credit for it, but in the last 2-3 years, we've seen many state governments and education departments have actually started started the clubs process in their schools itself. So now we're very happy. Whichever state announces, so it's not as if we have taken it, we say, okay, guys, you have to do these clubs, we'll help you set up clubs. We make sure there's a student leadership team. So you start building student leadership. Once you start building student leadership and they start taking charge, the school changes.
Sure.
You know? So in this program, I have seen the power of happiness.
Yep.
You know, I have seen the power of vibrancy. If schools can be made vibrant and happy places, you will actually see a turnaround happening.
Definitely. And that's, you know, so much true for the way you speak for the interventions and the programs you run through the years, that how you treat every school as an individual world in itself, rather than, you know, replicating everything as it is for everyone when it is not the way to go about it. Because it's just these ingenious ways that the way our country already is with the, you know, numerous geographies, people, culture and everything. So I guess that's there. Another important point that you brought out was about, you know, having this culture, which I'm pretty sure when you started, even with the Bharti Foundation, since you were the first ones to be a part of the team, you were the one leading that culture. And even when you talk about the schools that you're kind of working with, you are still establishing another type of culture around happiness that is there. So could you just elaborate on how do you proceed with culture as, you know, a non-existent thing for a lot of institutions, from, you know, that to consciously actually putting thought into making it something tangible?
You know, it isn't something that one can put down as a policy, you know, on paper. And one has to stay and remain very connected with the vision, you know, of your institution and of the program that you're running. Once you're connected with vision and you're making sure that entire team who is joined, you know, the most difficult part for any organization is to pass this chip of connection with vision, you know. this is one thing that we've done very well, you know, and the credit actually goes to all the leaders that we have in Bharti Foundation, right? There was a time initially that we won't start a meeting, be it a meeting with finance department or be it a meeting with even supply chain department, when at least one or two members would not share their last sense of what they were doing and connection with vision. You know, so an SCM person can actually say that I really liked selection of a training organization for our trainings, because, you know, when I was listening to their presentations, I realized that this training module is very important for our teachers. The moment, as an SCM person, you did not look at it only from a cost benefit bit, but you connected with vision in the scope of your job, it completely changes the way you're doing things, right? Yeah. So we have a very important thread that passes, which makes sure that everybody's connected with the vision. Our orientation is very important. We made sure that I and all the leadership teams, I actually write to teachers almost every 2 months. During COVID time, I wrote to them almost every month because I knew they needed to hear that things are okay and we'll come out of it, you know? And they were all working very hard. So I had to tell them that I'm seeing them, I'm hearing about them, right? So first is vision. Second is, what is it that you expect? A large part of our employees is teachers, right? So therefore I am focusing on teachers. If you want, how do you want your teachers to be, right? Ethical, committed. When a teacher is in a classroom, nobody is watching what she is doing. Am I correct? So till the time you don't have an ethical and committed teacher, the good quality education will not happen, right? Therefore, if we expect that of our teachers, every single thing that I do, I have to constantly measure myself on the same parameters, right? Sure. Because if I'm doing it like that, people who are observing me will see how strict I am with myself on those aspects, right? Why are we wearing double mask in Bharti Foundation? We're wearing double mask in Bharti Foundation because our teachers are wearing double masks, right? It's what you expect them to do is what we will do, and we will do it first, right? So
leading by example, in a way.
You can't have different benchmarks for. I know that many people feel that wearing a double mask when I'm alone in the office is not required, but you have to, right? Because I think ethics and value system is all about when nobody is watching you.
True.
Sure. Right? How are you performing then?
Yeah.
Right? Second, we've kept our system really very professional, right? So we try and be completely agnostic to when evaluation comes. We're agnostic to any other sub parameters and classes. We're very number driven and very, you know, very objective in how people are being evaluated. Now, this becomes very important, Deepak. Nobody should feel cheated because I am so and so, right? It's a completely different issue that at HR level, I personally monitor. So our head of HR has to look at performance evaluation, has to look at ratings given across social parameters and give me a certificate that he has not experienced any kind of discrimination happening, right? So he looks at bell curves, he looks at all of that. But on the ground, everything is done. So you have to know that if you do work well, mm-hmm. everything is objective. You will get your performance rating as per your performance. Okay. The second aspect is we have built in enough and more escalation metrics and processes, right? On the boards, there are, if you have a problem, even for community, right? If community finds something is wrong going on, or if they're not happy with something, they're told, okay, your level one is cluster coordinator, your level two is district head, your level three is regional head, your level four is then program head, and level five is CEO. My email ID is there
okay.
on the schools, right? In case of very serious issues, we've also put down the ombuds, which is at corporate, at the corporate level.
Okay.
Right? So if you think that you lodged a complaint and you don't think that you got justice from the organization, you can even go to the ombud office, which sits above, you know, even Bharti Foundation structure, right? So what that does is, you know that if you're not happy with something, there are people that you can reach out to, right? Yeah. Then the third piece, which is very important, is to celebrate. So there are certain days that are in the calendar itself. So how we celebrate Teacher's Day, there are calendar days when you know that you're celebrating. Those are the days when teachers who've done well are given ERA awards. So we have special badges for our teachers, right? It's a little badge. And if you go to our schools, teachers who have won an ERA stands for Educational Rockstar Achievers.
Okay.
So you will find teachers wearing sometimes 2-3, it depends on how many have they won. So I realized that they were all, collecting. One I have won 2 years back, one I have won 1 year back, and they have this long chain of ERA award badges, on their iCard, on the iCard that they wear. Plus HR does a lot of processes of celebrations and things like that. So we made sure that there are times we celebrate each other, because most of the time, as in any professional system, you're focused on what I have to deliver, and you're being asked to present your KPIs. So it's a very professionally driven system. So we take those times out to even celebrate each other. So
great.
I think that's how we've been able to just build in this DNA of professionalism, honesty, happiness, truth and integrity. Very important for us.
Great. And that's really phenomenal, the way you're approaching the whole, community aspect of it, to be treating everyone individually and, putting that sense of importance that they have as an individual and the role that they have to play in the whole chain of education dissemination in those communities. And again, just talking about these communities, so what role do you think the stakeholders that are playing, so say the parents like you already mentioned, and the teachers, so is that something that can be replicated by the technology like we are seeing in the current time, where the Zoom meetings are happening for the classes as well? And secondly, again, for the communities, so you also mentioned that the students that go through your system of, your initiative kind of become these change makers in themselves. So how are they kind of pushing the communities forward by bringing in the new age, I would say, thinking or thought processes there?
So for us, community is a very critical pillar. And I really very firmly believe that from day one, because we had community and parents, so I'm taking them as two groups, they are parents and then there is community, right? From day one, we've had community as an integral part of our schools. And that's a key reason why our schools are doing so well, right? So it's a two-way process, right? What community, and right now I'm not talking of parents.
Okay.
Every year for 10 to 15 days, we call it community volunteering. It's almost like a sabha camp. We started this because we realized that our kids, we send them for summer camps and things like that, right? These kids in the villages, underprivileged children, will not have such opportunities. So how do we bring summer camp into the schools and into their lives?
Interesting.
So we did two things. First, we said it's very important that they understand their own community. Yep. Okay. It's very important that they understand the employment and vocational opportunities they have around their life itself, right?
Yeah.
Correct? So for 10 to 15 days, in a way, we hand over our schools to the community, right? Teachers curate it. So you could have a local doctor coming in from primary healthcare center, nurse coming in. You could have a postman coming in, right? I've seen photographs of car repairman coming in, right? He comes with his van and I've seen photographs, he's opened this thing and all wires out and, he's explaining. So what happens is there are these sessions where these people take them through what their professions are, what does it entail. It builds up children's vocabulary. So when a doctor comes in, he says, this is stethoscope, correct? Now, even a class one child will struggle with this word, but, they learn new things. And then And then their dreams and aspirations are built in. You would bring in army officers. You will make sure that you will bring in enough women professionals, right? So if there's a lady sarpanch would come. Our girls should aspire to be a lady sarpanch, right? Then what we do is we get many mothers to come and teach local crafts. So whether it is mehndi, whether it is rope making, correct? So whatever is the local craft and art, these mothers come in. And it's so interesting. You know, they actually get a certificate of teaching from us, right? Depending on the classes that they've taken. There are, you know, the elders from the community come in. They'll tell them stories of past years. Those 10 to 15 days are very important for community, you know, because they feel that they have contributed into the school. That's their space, right? Our teachers curated to make sure that everything that gets done has a learning component in it. But what happens is in those 10, 15 days, our kids have had fun, right? So that's like summer camp for them. So we make sure that community is contributing, and this is straight contribution into, I would say, academics. And this is something I was so happy to see that NEP talked about. I was so happy, you know? Then in all the school functions, so, you know, when we are celebrating our teachers, awards are being given, we make sure sarpanch, panchayat, and apart from parents are obviously are there. They are there when they see, and you know, more than 50% of our head teachers are women.
Okay.
Our head teachers are given a laptop. All right. And all the teachers of that school, be it male or female, are reporting into this head teacher. Now, our lady head teacher, we train all our teachers on communication, how to negotiate, because they have to negotiate things with local sarpanches, right? You see these women leaders holding the mic, holding the entire school. And when you have community watching women leadership day in, day out.
Yeah.
We don't have to do anything to change mindsets.
Yeah.
Mindsets change.
Definitely.
Right? We now have parents saying, so we do this socioeconomic impact for schools. Earlier on, parents used to say, okay, we would get our daughter married by so-and-so age, and we saw the age going up. Now a large number of our parents are saying, yeah, we'll marry her off when she wants to, which means now they don't have a cutoff age. I'm very happy to hear that.
It is.
Right? I mean, there are parents who say, okay, now I want my daughter to study and become a teacher in Satya Bharti school, you know, because they feel it's so rewarding, actually. Some of our young girl teachers, when they're getting married, they actually tell their parents that, okay, Satya Bharti schools are in these villages, so get me a boy from these villages.
Great.
You know, because they feel safe, they feel respected, right? I know that most of our schools are primary and elementary, and the 30 schools that we turned into elementary, especially in Rajasthan, Jodhpur, parents approached us and they said, we feel so safe sending daughters to your schools.
Mm-hmm.
You know, please make them. So we upgraded our schools up to elementary. And now what we've done is under our government school program, quality support program, we're now working with the senior secondary schools in the neighborhood so that when our children pass out, they join a government school which we are, you know, partnering with. I don't know if I answered your question.
Definitely did. And in more ways than you can actually, you know, fathom. Because then again, it's just too simple to say that you're putting the community first. But when you actually give them the ownership is actually when you're actually practicing what you're preaching. Because once they take ownership of it is when they actually realize that how crucial that aspect of education is. And like you mentioned that, you know, now this, your schools actually stand for safe spaces for these children to come and play or whatever, you know, learn and grow into, you know, confident individuals for even future generations to take forward. So that's really phenomenal as a work that you're doing, and everything just speaks for itself. And now coming to, you know, this private public partnership model that you kind of, you know, perfected, I would say. So how has that been replicated, and how are you taking that a step further to improve the access of resources as well as individuals for every institution that you're building, and how can other organizations or institutions take benefit from that?
So this also has been a great learning space for us. I must say that we found exceptionally innovative officers in the government departments who've kind of worked with us. They've helped us evolve, right? We've had very good partnerships, received wonderful inputs, and our programs have evolved accordingly. So we've had 3-4 forms of public-private partnerships, Deepak. There's a program we've stopped it in 2018 or 19, which was a program of bringing out-of-school children back into schools. We worked with Rajasthan government, Madhya Pradesh government, and Jharkhand, some of the very difficult areas. And I think we brought 36,000 or 37,000 out-of-school children back in. There were 15 blocks in the year 2017-18, which were declared out-of-school children free, you know? So we were not the only ones, but we were part of a team. Government is also constantly working on bringing out-of-school children back, but we had worked extensively in those blocks. So that was a very interesting model where government had actually identified the difficult villages and difficult areas for us. They were kind enough to give us a room for this out-of-school children center in one of the government schools. You know, it's very important that you bring the children into the school itself, where you're going to mainstream them, you know. So that was a very impactful program we ran, and which finally evolved into the quality support program about which that I'm talking now. Then is the quality support program, right? And what we're seeing now, very interesting outcome of quality support program. We started with in-school program. So we would partner 50, 100, 150 schools, and we'll work with them in clusters. And when some of the state education officers or block of education officers, they saw the kind of changes that were happening, they actually got invited to share some of the practices and processes at a state level or district level. You know, so there have been some very good programs. For example, in we have this process of turning parents into home mentors, and we had it before COVID, right? Although most of our parents are not literate, but there is a role they can play in a child's education, even if it is to see, is there a balance between playing time, TV time, and study time? Even if it to see, was there any homework given? Have you done that or not, right? In many states, our home mentoring process, I think in Assam, we would be reaching some 1 to 1.5 lakh parents with the home mentoring process. So we've kept it simple. We are training their master trainers, we are training their teachers, and finally teachers will train parents on how to become home mentors. And when parents start contributing and they become partners with teachers, it takes completely different shape. Similarly, we have student level workshops where we train students on how to take notes, how to manage stress. Sometimes children before exams get completely stressed out, right? We teach them how to do time management, so the very simple modules. I think in Jammu and many other states, they want us to train their teachers on these modules so that, you know, they're working with their senior students. And it's very important to start training children on all of this from very early in life, because that is what real life is all about. There's always some kind of stress one is going through, or there's a time target that one is dealing with. So we're very excited about the kind of shape our quality support program has taken. We're very happy about the kind of response we're getting from the government and the value that government is seeing in our work. And again, going back to, because all these processes are coming from our Satya Bharti schools, you know, so we run them on ground, we fail and learn, but by the time the, you know, process is perfected, then we are ready to share it. So I am excited about Bharti Foundation's future because we come from very ground perspective when we come and talk at either policy level or partner government schools.
Great. And now again, just closing the conversation, so around the vision itself of the organization. So is there a particular intervention or thematic area that you're looking to explore, or even if geographies are something that you would like to expand your projects into?
We would be very excited about the NEP.
Okay.
Um, this new education policy, the way it's looking at education and the way it has given importance to post-scholastic, co-curricular, you know, the fact that a child has to be looked as a complete being, you know, while of course learning levels and foundational skills are important, but I personally believe that if a child who's coming into school is worried, tensed, because, you know, there's some sickness at home or something like that. If a child enters school, if she is not able to forget everything and concentrate on studies, and you may have the best teachers and a best system, the child may not learn, right? So we believe that, so I'm very happy, we're very excited about NEP. It talks a lot of areas in which Bharti Foundation works, which is, you know, beyond learning levels. And on the other hand, our quality support program is picking up scale, right? So our future is about bringing these two realms together and to see that how to take the vision of NEP, which really fits in so well with what our vision has been about education, and to take it at scale and to work with the government school system on this.
Great. And my best wishes for you for every endeavor that you're kind of venturing into. And with that, we come to the close of the conversation. Thank you so much for joining us, Mrs. Akia. It's been a pleasure. And I've thoroughly enjoyed the conversation today. Thank you so much.
Same here, Deepak. An open invitation to visit our schools once COVID is over.
Okay. Great.